Figure 10.22 is a graph of the angular velocity versus time for a disk rotating like a merry-go-round. For a point on the disk rim, rank the instance A, B, C, and D according to the magnitude of the tangential acceleration and the radial acceleration, greatest first. Okay, so starting off with the tangential acceleration, we know tangential acceleration is equal to R alpha. And we have to recognize that alpha, the angular acceleration, is the slope of the angular velocity curve as a function of time. So here is our angular velocity as a function of time. So we see the slope is the greatest here. But we're talking about the magnitude of the slope. So here the slope is the steepest. Here the slope is the next steepest. And at B and D, the slope is zero. So C is our greatest tangential acceleration, A is next, and B and D tie for last place with zero angular acceleration. Radial acceleration, we know the equation for radial acceleration, also called centripetal acceleration, is R omega squared. So all we have to do is look at the values of omega, and the ranking of R omega squared will be the same as the ranking of the values of omega. So B first, then A and C tie, and then D last. And that's what we've got here. Number two, figure 10.23b is a graph of the angular position of the rotating disk of figure 10.23a. Is the angular velocity of the disk positive, negative, or zero at time points 1, 2, and 3 seconds? And is the angular acceleration positive or negative? Well, here we have to always look at the graph and see what we're looking at. Position as a function of time. So the slope of position as a function of time is angular velocity. At time point 1, the slope is positive. At time point 2, the slope is 0. At time point 3, the slope is negative. And for the angular acceleration, we see here to the left of time equals 2 seconds, our slope is positive and the slope is decreasing. It's positive angular velocity, but decreasing. And then to the right of t equals 2 seconds, it's negative angular velocity, but the slope is increasing. So this is negative acceleration, because when the velocity is positive, it's slowing down. And when the velocity is negative, it's speeding up, indicating a torque in the negative direction. And of course, angular acceleration is going to be in the same direction as the torque. Another way of remembering this is angular acceleration is negative when the position time graph is concave down. Number three, figure 10-24 shows a uniform metal plate that has been square before 25% of it was snipped off. Three lettered points are indicated. Rank them according to the rotational inertia of the plate around a perpendicular axis through them, greatest first. Recall that moment of inertia depends not only on the amount of mass, but how it's distributed. So no matter which axis we rotate about, A, B, or C, the amount of mass is the same. But for B, we see a lot of the mass is close to the axis, and for C, most of the mass is far away from the axis. A is kind of in between. So we can rank our inertias then, C, about point C being the greatest, about point A being next, and about point B being the least inertia. Figure 10-25 shows plots of angular position theta versus time t for three cases in which a disk is rotated like a merry-go-round. In each case, the rotation direction changes at a certain angular position called theta subchange. For each case, determine whether theta subchange is clockwise or counterclockwise from theta equals zero, or whether it is at theta equals zero. For each case, determine whether omega is zero before, after, or at t equals zero, and whether alpha is positive, negative, or zero. So let's try and understand what they're asking here. This at first was a little confusing to me. Theta change is where the slope of the graph is zero. Right? The slope here is negative, and then it becomes positive. So that means the angular velocity changed direction. So right there is where the direction changed. So that's the angle they're talking about right there. And we see from the graph for the green line, number one, that is about 40 degrees maybe. If this gray line is 45 degrees, it's a little less than that. For the purple or graph number two, it's probably around 50 degrees. And for the blue one, it is at 0 degrees. So that's what I've labeled right here. I've used some polar graph paper to give the answers to this one. So like we said, it's about 40 degrees. So here it is, 40 degrees on our polar graph paper. We see the position is coming in from an angle greater than 90, slowing down, reaching 40 degrees, briefly stopping, and then moving back towards 90. So here it is. It's coming in from this direction, and it gets to right here. It stops, and then it goes the other way. Let's see what this looks like. Then, number two, it's coming from an angle at negative 90 degrees, then 0, then to about 50 degrees, and then back the other way. So here, negative 90 degrees, it's coming in this way, it's slowing down, it's slowing down, it's slowing down. It gets to about 50 degrees, and then it turns around and starts going back the other way. And then number three, it's coming in from the positive 90 side and makes it to theta equals 0 and then goes back. So it comes this way, gets to 0, and then goes back the other way. Then the acceleration, here we have negative velocity changing to positive velocity. So that's going to require a positive acceleration. So 1 and 3 are positive acceleration. For number 2, we have a positive slope that is slowing down, and then a negative slope that is increasing. So that's a negative acceleration. So in other words, for the position time graph, concave up is positive acceleration, and concave down is negative acceleration. Number 5, figure 1026A is an overhead view of a horizontal bar that can pivot. Two horizontal forces act on the bar, but it is stationary. If the angle between the bar and F2 is now decreased from 90 degrees, and the bar is still not to turn, should the magnitude of F2 be made larger, smaller, or left the same? It's told that the bar is stationary, so that means the torques must be equal. So if we change the angle of F2, the torque from F2 will decrease because 90 degrees will give us the maximum torque between a force and the lever arm. So in order to keep the torque the same, to still balance out with F1, the magnitude of F2 will have to increase because we only use the component of it that is perpendicular to determine the torque. So you can see here in this picture, if this perpendicular component of F2 is to remain the same as it was before, then F2 along this dashed line will have to be larger. Figure 1026B shows an overhead view of a horizontal bar that is rotated about the pivot point by two horizontal forces, F1 and F2, with F2 being at angle phi to the bar. Rank the following values of phi according to the magnitude of the angular acceleration of the bar, greatest first, 90, 70, and 110. Well, we get the maximum torque from an angle of 90 degrees. So 90 is going to give us the maximum F2. 70 and 110, we only use the component of F2 that is perpendicular to the bar. So that's F2 sine phi. So the sine of 70 and the sine of 110 are the same. So in other words, it doesn't matter if we tilt it towards the bar or away from the bar, the component of F2 that is perpendicular to the bar will be the same for both 70 and 110. So the answer then is we get our greatest torque with F2 at 90, and then in second place with 110 and 70 degrees tied. It doesn't really matter about F1, how it compares to F2, because it's in the same direction as F2. It produces a torque that's in the same direction. So this is, we can treat this as a constant over here. Number 7. In figure 10-27, two forces, F1 and F2, act on a disc that turns about its center like a merry-go-round. The forces maintain the indicated angles during the rotation, which is counterclockwise and at a constant rate. However, we are to decrease the angle theta of F1 without changing the magnitude of F1. To keep the angular speed constant, should we increase, decrease, or maintain the magnitude of F2? And do forces F1 and F2 tend to rotate the disc clockwise or counterclockwise? If we want to maintain a constant angular speed, that means the net torque has to remain zero. There's no acceleration. So if I decrease theta, that means less of F1 is producing torque. So that means I have to decrease F2 as well to maintain the same net torque of zero. F1, you can see its tangential component points this way. So that will tend to produce a clockwise torque, and F2, so that is going to produce a counterclockwise torque. Number 8. In the overhead view of figure 10-28, five forces of the same magnitude act on a strange merry-go-round. It is a square that can rotate about point P at mid-length along one of the edges. Rank the forces according to the magnitude of the torque they create about point P, greatest first. There's three concepts that you can think about when thinking about this problem and torque. Two of them are very similar. Torque is equal to F perpendicular times R. We'll call that concept number one. Or torque is equal to F times R perpendicular. We'll call that concept number two. And then concept number three, if the line of action passes through the axis of rotation, no torque is produced. And we'll show you what the line of action is as well. Okay, so looking at concept number one, I'm going to pick three forces that have the same R value. R is the distance from the axis of rotation to the location of where the force is being applied. So you see F1, F2, and F3 all have an R value that is 1/2 the side of the square. So if I can compare their F perpendiculars, I can rank their torques. So here's concept number three at work. The line of action, take a line that goes through the vector. There it is. And if the line of action passes through the axis of rotation, then it produces no torque. In other words, there is no F perpendicular for force number three. F3 and the R vector are in the same direction. For F1 and F2, however, there is a perpendicular component to R. Here is the perpendicular component of F1 to R1, and here is the component of F2 to R2. And now we can see that the torque produced by F1 is less than F2. So the torques rank then greatest F2, then F1, then F3. If we use our other way of thinking of it, that torque is equal to F times R perpendicular, this is probably the best one to use for this problem because all of the forces are the same. So if we can rank them by their R perpendiculars, we can rank them by the torque as well. Here is our line of action for F5. My R perpendicular is the width of the square. So that's a pretty big moment arm, we call it. This R perpendicular we call the moment arm. Then for F4, there's my line of action there. The moment arm is 1/2 the length of the square. The moment arm for F1 is right there. That's going to be less than the moment arm for F2, which is about that distance right there. For F3, the moment arm passes through the axis of rotation. So that's like saying a moment arm of 0. So then I can rank my torques 5, 4, 2, 1, 3. with 5 being the greatest and 3 being the least. Number 9. A force is applied to the rim of a disc that can rotate like a merry-go-round so as to change its angular velocity. Its initial and final angular velocities, respectively, for 4 situations are shown below. Rank the situations according to the work done by the torque due to the force, greatest first. In 2 of the instances, we see the direction of the disc changes. Here it changes from moving in the negative direction to moving in the positive direction. And in line D, we see it goes from moving in the positive direction to moving in the negative direction. In these 2 instances, line B and C, the disc remains moving in the same direction. But you'll notice that when we plug the numbers into the equations, we get the same result for all 4. So they all tie in terms of the amount of net work done. So that's important, net work. Here we do negative work, slowing the wheel from -2 to 0, and then positive work to speed it up from 0 to 5. The same thing goes down here. We do negative work to slow it down from 2 radians per second to 0 radians per second, and then positive work to speed it up from 0 radians per second to 5 radians per second. Don't forget the negative sign just indicates the direction of the angular velocity. So the negative work in lines A and D, then when you add that to the positive work, you get the same amount of work, the same amount of net work that you get from going just from 2 to 5. So that's what we see in the equations then. The amount is the same for all. Number 10. Figure 1029 shows 3 flat discs of the same radius that can rotate about their centers like merry-go-rounds. Each disc consists of the same 2 materials, one denser than the other. In discs 1 and 3, the denser material forms the outer half of the disc area, and in disc 2, it forms the inner half of the disc area. Forces with identical magnitudes are applied tangentially to the disc, either at the outer edge or at the interface of the 2 materials, as shown. Rank the discs according to the torque about the disc center, the rotational inertia about the disc center, and the angular acceleration of the disc, greatest firsts. Okay, so the torque, since the forces are the same, we rank the torques by the moment arm. So disc 1 and disc 2 have a larger moment arm than disc 3, so their torques for 1 and 2 are the same, and that is larger than disc 3. The moments of inertia, remember, the distribution of mass is important, even though all 3 discs have the same mass, because more of the mass is closer to the axis of rotation for number 2, it has the least moment of inertia, and 1 and 3 have the same moment of inertia. So that's what we see here. 1 and 3 are the same, and they're greater, and 2 is the least, because more of its mass is near the axis of rotation. And then the angular acceleration is torque divided by moment of inertia. So that means our greatest acceleration is going to be the greatest torque divided by the smallest inertia. And the smallest acceleration is going to be the smallest torque divided by the largest inertia. So that gives us an order.